Welcome, Commissioner Brill, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to have you all here this morning. My name is Daniela Schwarzer, and I'm the director of GMF's Berlin office. We are relaunching this morning a series called the Transatlantic Talks, and it's the first time since Sudha, David-Wilp, and I took over the leadership of the Berlin office that we have this series here. It's a special pleasure to have the two of you here today. The Transatlantic Talks are supposed to be a transatlantic conversation, no long speeches, but really an animated and provocative debate. And the issue today, of course, privacy and security in a digital age lends itself to that kind of conversation, in particular here in Berlin, where I think we all know and feel how, in a way, an inconclusive debate on surveillance issues between Europe or Germany and the United States has actually led to an erosion of trust and a weakening of the transatlantic relationship. So it's a great pleasure to relaunch the series. We have it ongoing in Washington, D.C. The idea is always to have someone from the other side of the Atlantic, a policymaker, come over and to have a conversation with a well-known journalist. And I think we have one of that species here, Cherno, who is a presenter at ZDF, and not only that, he's also the editor of the Huffington Post here in Germany. And before we start the conversation between the two of you, Sudha, David-Wilp will present a study which is the result of a transatlantic digital dialogue which GMF put together with Stiftung Neue Verantwortung. Sudha was the director of the project and spearheaded the whole idea, so I'll pass the floor to you for a brief presentation of the results, and that will directly lead into your discussion. Thank you so much for being here.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Sudha David-Wilp, and I'd like to thank you for coming to this first transatlantic talk that Daniela and I put together. As Daniela mentioned, we at GMF worked together with the Stiftung Neue Verantwortung to put together a study on how to rebuild trust between Germany and the United States. The objective was to bring together a group of German and American experts from civil society, from business, to talk about different ways to find concrete, forward-looking solutions to bridge the gap in trust across the Atlantic. Over the last year, the group met via video conference, and this was an exercise to accompany the official cyber dialogue between the German Foreign Ministry and the US State Department. We felt that in a post-Snowden world, that it was important to talk about a transnational, rights-based framework for looking at privacy and security today. So as I mentioned, I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag. There are reports on everybody's chair, but there were broad recommendations essentially found by the group, touching on oversight and transparency, extraterritorial access to data, and cybersecurity and encryption. So I think that there's a lot of food for thought for Cherno and Commissioner Brill to discuss today, and we look forward to your questions. Before I pass the floor over to Cherno, I wanted to give a special thanks to some colleagues here in the Berlin office, specifically Francie over there in the back, and Tom, who helped put this together, along with some other colleagues here in the office. So Cherno, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Transatlantic Talk here at German Marshall Fund. Prior to October 6, digital economy was easy in the transatlantic days because, you know, you just could do your business. There was a safe harbor agreement. You could just put the data from Europe to the other end of the world. Everything was fine. But on October 6, that ended. The European Court of Justice declared that safe harbor illegal. What do we do now? It all started in 2013, you know, in the light of the Snowden Snowden papers and the Snowden interviews, let's say it better, you know, that people said, well, can we trust it? Is safe harbor still safe harbor? So how do we deal with that? And I'm very glad to have the FTC Commissioner, Julie Brill, here to talk about that. Hello.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
You just came over. How's your jet lag?
Oh, I have been in Europe now for about 4 or 5 days, so I'm completely acclimated, no problem.
So we can fight.
We can fight, I'm ready. I won't have that excuse.
Okay, good. Let's start with the European Court of Justice decision. You know, is it really that important? I mean, is it really that?
Yes, the short answer is yes. But first, let me just say thank you to the German Marshall Fund. Thank you to Daniela, to Sudha, and to the entire team here for organizing this transatlantic dialogue. I can think of nothing more important than having this discussion between US officials and the German public about what is happening with respect to data flows, what is happening with respect to issues around privacy.
But so, tell me, yes. What happened when you heard about the decision?
Yes.
Did your heart stop? Do you say,
I'll be honest with you. I was saddened by the decision. And I know we'll talk about various other reactions. But what the decision did was it invalidated the European Commission's 2000 decision to allow for, to basically say that the safe harbor framework was adequate and would allow for data flows under the safe harbor framework in the absence of declaring the United States to be an adequate country under the European framework. There were 4,500 companies that were using safe harbor to transfer data. Now, I know a lot of people here in Berlin and in Germany talk about, you know, the very largest companies that were using safe harbor, Google, Facebook.
But we're talking about law, not about big companies.
That's my point. My point is that there were some big companies, but the vast majority of those companies that were using safe harbor were small and medium enterprises. And the vast majority of the data that was flowing was HR data, human resources data. And what does that mean? That means that safe harbor was about jobs. It was about jobs, both in Germany and in the United States. So what, by invalidating the decision, what's going to happen is it's going to be much harder for these smaller companies to figure out how, if they can, make these data flows happen about their employees or about their customers. It's going to be much harder for them.
Yeah, but jobs are jobs, human resource, okay, but law is law, and a court decision is a court decision.
Absolutely. I'm not questioning the court decision. I'm not saying that the court decision is wrong or invalid. The court decision is what it is. I'm just telling you my reaction was not one of happiness, but was one of sadness.
Was that the moment privacy advocates were waiting for?
To a certain extent, I think that there were lots of advocates. Well, first of all, I want to also be clear. I am a privacy advocate. We didn't talk about my background, just so everybody knows. I have spent, before I became a commissioner of the Federal Trade Commission in the United States, which I've now done for about 5 years, I spent over 20 years doing privacy, consumer protection, and competition enforcement work at the state level in the United States. I worked for state AGs, state attorneys general in Vermont, and in North Carolina. So I've done nothing but enforcement work in privacy and other areas for my entire career. I'm a privacy advocate. But I take, I think, a nuanced view.
What does it mean, nuanced view?
Nuanced means it's not like up or down. It's not like yay or what it means is I can see good in the decision and I can see problems with the decision. I've already talked about some of the problems.
What is the good spot?
The good thing about the decision is it made quite clear to companies in the U.S. and to policymakers in the U.S. in a way that hadn't been made clear before that in Europe, privacy on the commercial side, not the government surveillance side, but on the commercial side, is a fundamental right. It's not about protectionism, which frankly a lot of people in the United States have felt.
Really?
That privacy. Oh, absolutely. But I have been saying in Silicon Valley, in Washington, and everywhere else that I've been speaking in the United States, that what the decision made quite clear is that in Europe, in the commercial sector, privacy is a fundamental right. And I think that message has now started to get through in the United States.
But on the other side, in the European suspect, you know, you Americans, you talk about security, but generally it felt for us like pro-business. You're just pro-business and you don't care about the rest. Is it a totally wrong perception?
I think it's totally wrong. I don't know how else to say it. I mean,
be more specific. Come on,
yes,
Julie, tell me. Explain to me. There are cameras. Why not?
Look, to say that people in the United States don't care about privacy, which is what that is essentially saying, is just absolutely wrong. Privacy in the United States is something that is deeply important, but it is more complicated than it is here in Germany or in Europe. In Germany and in Europe more generally, there is usually a single law that talks about how data shall flow. In the United States, it's more complicated, but that doesn't mean that it isn't robust. In fact, we have very robust laws in the United States, and much more importantly, I believe we have more robust enforcement of our privacy laws than absolutely.
We don't know that. How does it come that we don't know that? It's kind of surprising. You are more robust than we are.
So, in enforcement, It is absolutely true. So let me explain why you don't know it. I can't explain. You obviously know a lot about the United States. You know, if you've been in touch with Ariana Huffington, you certainly are very well connected to U.S. issues. I do. No question.
No comment on that.
No question. But look, I also want to make clear that it's complicated and people in the U.S. don't really understand it either. So it's not really knowing our country or not knowing our country or knowing our culture or not knowing our culture. So here's the deal. When it comes to sensitive information, health information, information about kids, information about financial issues, information about critical decisions that are made about data that's used for critical decisions about consumers, employment, insurance, credit, housing, we have very robust laws that deal with the protection of that data. So what we have done in the United States is we've said, look, let's figure out what is sensitive. What are the sensitive types of information? And let's protect that. In addition to the federal...
But couldn't it be that what you think is sensitive and we think is sensitive is just a difference?
No, I actually don't think that's the problem. I do think, though, that we need to modernize our laws in the United States in order to better reflect the fact that, like, for instance, health information. Yep. Health information is no longer simply held by doctors, insurance companies, and hospitals. Health information can flow through apps, through a lot of other information, and it can be derived from much more mundane information. People can collect that and take it and figure out health conditions and whatnot. And there have been experiments, very famous experiments that have shown that. So I think that our laws in the United States can be improved, mm-hmm. but that isn't any different than the laws here in Europe. I mean, look, the directive is undergoing a massive improvement effort. That's what the GDPR is about. So, all laws that are 10, 15 years old, just like Safe Harbor was 15 years old, directive more than 20 years old, a lot of these laws in the United States, 20 years old or so, given the massive amount of data that's flowing, given the digital age that we're in, they all can use refurbishment and buffing up. And that's definitely true in the United States.
And when will that happen?
It's happening now. So I want to get to the security stuff in a second, but you asked me about enforcement, and I really want to touch on this because, you said it's like you seemed surprised that we have robust enforcement in the United States. Let me be really clear that we at the FTC, in addition to those laws that deal with sensitive information, we have a law that says we can proceed against companies that are engaged in unfair or deceptive practices. We have brought hundreds of cases under both those specific laws and under our unfair and deceptive acts and practices law. We have not only brought cases against the very biggest companies, the Googles and Facebooks of the world, but also very small players that play a critical role in the digital ecosystem. So ad networks, data brokers, analytics firms, software firms, hardware firms, all of whom we believed were engaged in practices that were either collecting information where they didn't tell consumers adequately about it, were doing inappropriate things with sensitive information, were not telling consumers the truth about how they were using information, were using information or collecting information for one purpose and then using it for a very different purpose, all sorts of issues that led to enforcement actions. And what did those enforcement actions result in? They resulted in the vast majority of cases, a consent order that lasts for 20 years that requires these companies to report to us on a biannual basis what they're doing to improve privacy. And if they violate those orders, then we can impose penalties. I mean, this is serious stuff. So, the fact that Germans don't understand all that we do with respect to privacy enforcement is very understandable because it's also true in the United States.
Coming back to the court decision, Penny
yes.
Pritzker, the American Commerce Secretary, said that the court decision, I quote, that puts at risk the thriving transatlantic digital economy, end of quote. What are the risks? Is it really that dangerous?
Again, this is part of why I was saddened by the decision. Again, there were some good things. Again, it made clear to the U.S., the fundamental right for commercial privacy, which frankly isn't that different from the way the U.S. views government use of information. You know, everybody says in the United States we don't think that there's a fundamental right to privacy. Well, that isn't true. I'm going to get to your question in a second. But it's important for me to say this. It's important to note that in the United States, the Fourth Amendment is a fundamental right. Mm-hmm. And the Fourth Amendment applies to government use of information. And the courts, the Supreme Court and the circuit courts, have looked at the Fourth Amendment in the context of new collections of data.
Just for everybody to understand, what is the Fourth Amendment? If you just, you know,
I'm sorry, the Fourth Amendment is a prohibition against inappropriate governmental searches and seizures. That's the way it's phrased. And it applies to data. And the Supreme Court has actually rendered decisions about the police use, for instance, of GPS devices being surreptitiously placed on individuals' cars and other much more modern forms of searches and seizures of data and information about individuals. So in the US, it isn't that foreign to think about privacy is a fundamental right. The difference is we focus on government and government use of data as a fundamental right. Here in Europe, what we in the United States, not me because I've known this for a while, but what many people are trying to get used to is, okay, that's also true in the commercial space. So I think, again, it's kind of a nuanced revelation that has taken place in the United States. But with
But the transatlantic, you know, perspective in that, you know, the way you feel, the way we feel, it's kind of different and it's kind of not that different. So can you understand the German or the European sensitivity on that issue? Let's say because of our special history right now here, this East Germany, the wall was like 50 meters down the road.
I know.
And people, it's only 25 years ago, we kind of.
Yeah.
The little the better.
I am very aware of the special circumstances here in Germany and all that the German public feels about how data has been used in inappropriate ways. What I'm about to describe, I don't think rises to the level of what was experienced here in Germany. But you know, in the US too, there's a strong concern about how information can be used to harm individuals. You know, whether we want to talk about McCarthyism or J. Edgar Hoover, you know, there have been issues in the United States that have led to very strong advocacy around privacy and especially around government use of information, which is why I wanted to point out the existence of the Fourth Amendment and how it is a fundamental right. But let's go back to Penny Pritzker's quote, because, you know, look, I think what Penny Pritzker, who's the Secretary of Commerce, was trying to say is this isn't only about the 4,500 companies, the SMEs, the small and medium enterprises, as well as those few large companies that had signed up for Safe Harbor. When you really sit back and think about it, what the decision in its implications could mean if we can't solve the problem, which frankly I think we can solve, and I'm very much eager that it be solved, but if we can't solve the problem, what is really put at risk is the free flow of information between 800 million people. You know, all of US citizenry and all of the people here in Europe. And we have so much in common and so much to talk about and so much that our democracies, our very strong democracies share, that free flow of information, I believe, is critical to continue to allow those democracies to flourish. But I also want to say that this wasn't just a comment by Penny Pritzker, because Mrs. Jourova, Vera Jourova, who is the European Commission's Commissioner for Justice, has also said something very similar. She said it is important, she said about the ECJ decision, that it is important that transatlantic data flows continue, as they are the backbone of our economy. Mm-hmm. So I think that there's a mutual recognition among the political leaders on both sides of the Atlantic that this is a very important decision that needs to be addressed.
I think the issue is not the data flow. The issue is what's happening with the data.
Absolutely.
Once it in the US. And you know, after 2013, when we heard about this guy from Hawaii who went to first China, then to Moscow, Ed Snowden, told us what is happening with data surveillance. And you know, a lot of people in Europe think, well, why do they do it? You know, what is, you know, is it? We don't get it, frankly. And you know, the recent shootings in San Bernardino, the guy met his wife and on the internet. He just brought her home and it didn't prevent it. So why do you guys do NSA? That's a basic question a lot of people think in Germany, and that's what I'd like to address here. Help me with that.
So I have to believe that I mean, you're posing that question in a very provocative way, and I have no problem
with
that.
I'm sorry.
No, I have no problem with that. I have no problem with that. I have to believe that Germans are as concerned about national security and ensuring that they are safe as are Americans. The question isn't whether you should have an NSA or whether you should have security forces. The question is, what's the appropriate balance mm-hmm. between privacy and security?
What is it?
Well, it's something that is not going to be decided in one moment in time. I think if we've learned anything in the United States is that it is an iterative discussion. It goes back and forth. It is a pendulum that is constantly being reassessed. And look, you know, the San Bernardino events, which were terribly tragic, are still clearly being evaluated. You know, what happened, what went wrong. We could talk about Paris in the same way and the Paris attacks. What did the security forces here in Europe, as well as in the United States, know or not know about the individuals that were involved? But what you can't describe easily is all of the incidences that were stopped as a result of information that was flowing through the security forces. Now, look, the other thing that we absolutely need to talk about, though, about this iterative conversation, is after the revelations came out about, you know, from Snowden with respect to how information was being used under the Patriot Act, there was a very robust conversation in the United States about whether the reforms were needed. Mm-hmm. And I think that the amount of discussion and the level of discussion in the United States has not been well translated here in Europe. You know, I talked.
So what did we miss?
Well,
we didn't
okay.
see the demonstrations like against NSA or something like. I didn't see it.
You know, demonstrations.
Or Snowden for president or whatever. I didn't see that.
Okay, yeah, you're not gonna. I don't think you'll see that. Well, you know, maybe, but what's really important is not the demonstrations. What's mm-hmm. really important are the results. Mm-hmm. So what did happen was. The Congress enacted USA Freedom Act. And USA Freedom Act had some very important elements to it, which included eliminating the bulk metadata collection, which what came out of the 215 program. It also included reforms to the FISA court, requiring that there be amicus availability. It required that the FISA court decisions of significance be made public to the extent that they could. It required that US government legal opinions about the collection and use of data to the extent that they could, to the extent that they're significant, also be made public. It put into place or codified the transparency, the improved transparency mechanisms that some of the major tech firms were using and had already been part of a legal settlement, it enshrined those improvements and increased transparency in law. Now, these aren't sound bites. It's hard to say this in 20 seconds, but this is incredibly important stuff. But in addition to the USA Freedom Act, which is now a law, was signed into law in June, and it's now starting to become effective. We have the Redress Act, which is working its way through Congress. It has now passed the House of Representatives. It will hopefully, I am hopeful that it will pass the U.S. Senate as well. In addition, I mean, you know, this is why I'm saying so much has happened. The Presidential Privacy Directive, PPD 28, which was put in place in June of 2014, made reforms that the president could make in the absence of legislation. So he called for certain reforms in terms of the way data was being used or not used. PCLOB, the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board.
So you kind of learned the lesson of Snowden?
I'm saying that this is not a single...
Just say yes or no.
Have we learned the lesson
of
Snowden?
Come on, Julie.
I do.
We're just among friends, you know.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, yeah. I do believe that there were important lessons that were learned from the revelations. I do. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
Oh, that was a German joke.
Okay.
A mixture of yes and no, like jein.
Okay. You know what we say? You know how we say it in the United States is we say, maybe, or so-so. But no, we did learn very important lessons from the Snowden revelations, and we did react, and reforms were made, and that is what is deeply important, and that is what I think has gotten lost. But I also want to say, PCLOB, Privacy Civil Liberties Oversight Board, has been reinvigorated, has issued now several very important reports, both about the 215 and 705 programs, and the president set up a presidential review group, which was made up of five, you know, esteemed leaders in security and also in privacy, which also came out with a report, and many of their recommendations were enacted in USA Freedom Act. Why do Europeans not focus on this? It's not something we can talk about in 20
seconds. It's always the media.
It's your fault. It's Cherno's fault. Now we know the reason. All right, so good. Now we've solved that.
Life can be easy, yeah. No, but coming back, you know, just talking about media, the German Marshall Fund partnered with Huffington Post for this event. You know, we asked our readers, you know, what kind of question they would like to ask the FTC commissioner. There were several questions coming in. And one question by a guy named Peter Miller, or in German language, Peter Müller. He said, you know, due to technical evolutions, you know, is sovereignty of a state just something of the past because, you know, borders are not borders like anymore? Shouldn't we get agreed to that? Shouldn't we, let's say, Germans have some stake in something like the FTC because it kind of, it affects us, what you guys are, your decisions?
That's interesting. I do, so, look, obviously there still is, you know, there still are national laws, there's still going to be sovereignty. Companies are going to very much strive to obey national laws. So I don't think sovereignty is going away. But having said that, the internet is a global medium, and the internet is a fabulous platform for international conversations. And one of my concerns, taking this back to Safe Harbor, taking this back to the ECJ decision, you know, what the FTC has done and done very well is we have enforced the Safe Harbor provisions. We have brought 39 cases involving violations by companies of Safe Harbor, which does, I mean, the vast majority of companies were complying, had a lot of procedures and personnel in place in order to ensure that they did comply, but there were a few that slipped up. And so we brought enforcement actions. What the invalidation of the European Commission's 2000 decision to say that the Safe Harbor framework was inadequate, what that ECJ decision did was it took away my ability, the FTC's ability, we're a big agency, it's not just me, but I'm here, but the ability of the FTC to protect European citizens. Because we no longer have the Safe Harbor framework as a hook to use in our enforcement work. Mm-hmm. And enforcing BCRs, enforcing standard contractual clauses is gonna be much more difficult for the FTC. I'm not gonna say it's impossible, but it's much more difficult. Mm-hmm. So if you're, Peter Mueller is concerned about the FTC's role in protecting him and ensuring the sovereignty of European and German citizens, just know, Peter, that we are no longer, Peter, if you're out there, I hope you are, just know that my concern is my ability to protect you and to protect German citizens has been reduced as a result of this decision. Safe Harbor was an easy target for Europeans who were concerned about the revelations that they were hearing with respect to government surveillance and whatnot. But it was the wrong target, in my perspective, because Safe Harbor was a consumer protection tool, not something that was causing the problems from my perspective.
Huffington Post reader Sandra Ragovsky asked, you know, wouldn't it be okay if everybody would use encryption? Wouldn't that solve the problem? Like real heavy encryption that would guarantee everybody's privacy? Your take on that?
I am supportive of the tech companies that are seeking to implement encryption with respect to their consumer tools. And I am concerned about the law enforcement community in the United States, as well as other government officials who are calling for keys, whether we want to call them backdoor or under the front mat. There are all sorts of metaphors that are being used in the United States about what these mechanisms would be. But I am worried about the magical thinking, as I call it, that some in the law enforcement community seem to hold, that somehow you could create back doors for law enforcement to use, which won't be also exploited by hackers and bad guys. And so the president has called for the tech community to work with law enforcement to try to figure out this problem as well as other problems. Mostly the president has been focused on other problems involving social media and whatnot. But it's going to be hard to come up with a solution that will allow law enforcement to have access that other bad people won't be able to also exploit. Mm-hmm. So this will be a conversation. This conversation about encryption in the United States, also a very robust conversation where you have privacy advocates and you have government officials and you have policymakers all really kind of duking it out in the United States over this issue. This will be a conversation that will go on for a very long time. We saw it in the 90s, we're seeing it now, it's going to continue.
All right. The last question will be, before I open up to the audience, how do we continue, how do we get together? I mean, isn't the cultural gap between the Americas and Germany too deep, for example? You know, if you look at a classic example, we German males and females love to go naked into the same sauna. Americans don't do that. They love divided saunas. We guys don't like our house on Google Street View. You guys like to post everything on the web. You know, coming from sauna to digital stuff, aren't we just too different?
I like going to saunas.
All right.
So there we are. No.
Come on, you know what I'm talking about. That's too easy way out.
No, I do. I know precisely what you're talking about. And the truth is, of course, there are going to be cultural differences between every culture. Look, there are cultural differences within the United States. You know, if you look at the North and the United States, the South, you look at Silicon Valley, you look at New York, and I'm sure that's true here in Germany too. Bavaria versus Frankfurt. I mean, I think there's lots of differences within countries as well. But the truth of the matter is, from my perspective, and I think from the perspective of lots of scholars who've looked deeply at this, there is a tremendous amount that Germany and the United States share culturally, as well as, just more broadly, there's a lot that the US and Europe shares culturally. And I think that we need to celebrate and honor those things that we share and try to promote that through transatlantic dialogue rather than focus on all of our differences. The differences are interesting. They make life interesting. But it's not something that ought to divide us. And I want to give you one example in particular about this issue because I think this is really important. There was recently a study that was done about how privacy is practiced on the ground in five countries, the United States, Germany, France, England, the UK, and Spain. This was a study that was recently published by two Berkeley professors from the University of California in Berkeley. And what they found is that the practices on the ground in the United States and Germany are actually much closer than anywhere else, much closer than Germany versus France, Germany versus UK, Germany versus Spain.
Except the saunas.
Except what?
The saunas.
The what? Oh, the saunas. No, but what it found, I mean, this is actually really interesting because it's something that I think most people in Germany don't recognize. And frankly, probably most people in the United States don't recognize. But the way companies have dealt with privacy in Germany is very similar to how it's done in the United States. They have a conversation with their regulators. They try to figure out what's allowed, what isn't allowed. There's something that these Berkeley professors called productive ambiguity. Where the
what the hell does it mean?
Productive ambiguity means that there's enough ambiguity in the law, and the regulators have said not we're going to tell you what to do, companies, but instead the regulators have said you go figure this out, and we'll let you know if you're getting it right or wrong, but it's your job to figure it out. So what has that done? That has promoted the importance of the chief privacy officers and the privacy teams within companies that are based here in Germany and that are based in the United States. And this phenomenon is incredibly important, because it's not about how the laws are actually written, you know, what the laws say, but it's how privacy is done on the ground within companies. So it's just one example of how much I believe we actually share and that hasn't been recognized, because it's not visible. It's happening behind the scenes, but it's actually the way privacy is getting practiced, and that's why it's so important.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, FTC Commissioner Julie Brill is now ready to take your questions.
Hi, my name is Isabel from the Global Public Policy Institute here in Berlin. Thank you so much for this very interesting and entertaining conversation. My question relates to the Safe Harbor Agreement, and there's a deadline to renegotiate the agreement until January 2016. So my question to you is, how do you think will this agreement look like? And which conditions need to be met so that it's accepted both in Europe and the US, also in light of the ECJ's judgment? Thank you.
Thanks for that wonderful question. It is true, the Safe Harbor framework, because it was invalidated, or the decision to allow it to exist was invalidated. There are now discussions underway, largely between the European Commission and the Department of Commerce, to try to develop a new framework that would be adequate and that the Commission could deem to be adequate for transatlantic data flows. That discussion actually was going on before the Schrems decision, before the ECJ decision involving Max Schrems, but the discussion now had to incorporate some of the elements of the court's decision. The discussions are moving along. They're quite mature. The FTC has been involved because we will have to enforce the framework. As I said, one of the things about these frameworks is the FTC has the ability to protect European citizens because we become one of the enforcement arms of these of this kind of framework. So we've been involved, so I'm aware of the contours of the discussion. Because the discussion is very much live now, I don't think it's appropriate for me to talk about what's being discussed at the table. But I am not only hopeful, but also I believe that that these discussions will conclude satisfactorily to both sides and will include all the elements that would create a more robust and lasting framework for transatlantic data flows. I actually think the Safe Harbor framework was pretty good before. It needed, as I said, all of these old frameworks, Safe Harbor was 15 years old. The European Data Protection Directive, 15, 20 years old. A lot of the US laws also old. All of these things need refurbishment. Safe Harbor, no exception. It was ready for some improvements, but it was a pretty good framework. And let's be very clear, the Schrems decision, the ECJ decision, didn't talk at all about the provisions of the Safe Harbor framework. What it focused on, so it didn't say, the notice provisions aren't good, the access provisions aren't good, it's not providing X, Y, or Z, which should be provided under commercial law. The Schrems decision didn't talk about that at all. It didn't talk about FTC enforcement at all. In fact, the European Commission, in its 2013 letter, when it asked for improvements in Safe Harbor after the Snowden revelations, specifically said that the FTC enforcement is really great. We're not commenting at all about it trying to improve the way the FTC enforces Safe Harbor. So I think that the elements of Safe Harbor itself were good, but I think they will be improved and it will be a more robust framework.
But just ask a question that you just said, there are mature discussions,
Yes.
Can you give us some hints and what kind of maturity?
I think there are a few issues that are left on the table.
Like what?
I am a guest at the table. It's not my table.
But you have ears, you can speak.
I do, but I am a guest. I am not the host, it is not my house, it is not my food. I am sitting at the table.
But we are hungry.
You're hungry, I'm hungry too. And I absolutely do believe that there should be a new framework put in place. I'm a strong believer in that for all the reasons I've just talked about. Mm-hmm. but it's not my role to talk about the issues.
What would make me happy? You happy? Yeah, you are a guest at the table, you are listening, you are hungry too, and you know, what make you happy? Yeah, let's do it.
What would make me happy is to have protections in place so that Europeans would feel comforted that they have the basic rights that they have under European law, that they would exist through the framework. And frankly, I think they had that before. They had access.
Don't loophole.
What loophole? What loophole?
You said we had that before. The court said we didn't have it before.
No, the court didn't say that. No, it didn't. I think it's really important to be specific about what the court said. The court did not find a loophole in terms of the requirements for companies, what they had to do to give access, to give notice, to give correction rights to individuals. That was not the court's project. The court instead looked at the 2000 decision that determined that safe harbor was adequate and said the European Commission failed to address, because this was back in 2000, so it's understandable that the Commission didn't talk about government surveillance or redress rights for government access to information. That's not what the Safe Harbor framework is about. Look, the GDPR is going to have national security exceptions. The directive had national security exemptions. Safe Harbor had national security exemptions. The question was, how did those get interpreted by the governments, and what was the balance in terms of...
Thanks for clearing that.
Yeah.
I take the next question by the gentleman with the purple tie.
Johannes Ahlefeld, political advisor to German Social Democrats in Parliament. As I come from the security side, serving in a unit that deals with Parliament inquiries and intelligence oversight, two issues. Cybersecurity is one. Do you have a discussion on, let's say, encouraging security by design, let's say, putting an investment premium on these kind of issues in the future? Secondly, with a view to, let's say, the discussions on restoring trust in the global marketplace, the data mining companies obviously also not only sell their analyses and the data to private individuals or companies, they also serve state agencies. So there's a kind of link between the two discussions, I would say. So is there a chance of having legal redress and judicial review not only for US citizens but also for expats? We're discussing this not only with a view to commercial rights but also security services actions in this country.
Thank you very much.
Those are great questions. So with respect to cybersecurity, my agency, the FTC, I believe actually invented the term security by design. And I think it's great that that is being imported and discussed here in Europe. We did not invent privacy by design. That was invented by a North American rather than a US person. But it's something that we fully embraced, privacy by design, in our 2012 report about how privacy should be rethought in the United States. It's a very important report. I recommend it to all of you. But with respect to security by design, we started talking about that. Thank you so much. In a very serious way, excuse me. Thank you, Cherno. In our recent report in January 2015, dealing with the Internet of Things. Because the Internet of Things is an incredibly important area. We haven't even gotten into kind of where data flows are moving. But security is going to be one of the primary concerns around all these connected devices, many of which are going to basically be throwaways, going to be hard to do patches, hard to have user interfaces, hard to have user controls. We could talk about that if you want to. But security by design is going to be a very key element of ensuring that the Internet of Things will flourish and connected devices will flourish. So we are very focused on security. The other thing I want to say where Europeans have actually imported a concept from the United States. I know that Europeans think that, you know, privacy and security is something that you're much more concerned about than we are in the United States. I hope I have dispelled that through much of this conversation. But in addition to security by design being a concept that we have created, data breach notifications is something that has been in existence in the United States for 10 years. It happens at the state level, that is, it's the state legislatures, the vast majority of which, about 48, have enacted laws requiring companies to notify consumers and the public when they experience breaches of a certain size. That does not exist in Europe in a broad way to date. The GDPR will create a requirement for data breach notification, but that has been borrowed, I think quite importantly and usefully, from the United States. One of the reasons why I think Europeans are not as aware of the security problems that they likely face is because they're not being notified about breaches when they occur. Once the GDPR is enacted, once the data breach notification rules get put into place, I think Europeans will become much more aware about the extent of cybersecurity problems than they might be aware today.
Yeah, I indeed have a question on, you had mentioned earlier, you had mentioned your role, the FTC's role in the former safe harbor agreement. And I understand that in the current discussion, there's also some discussion about the possible future role of the FTC within eventual 2.0 agreement. So, and from our understanding, the European Commission is somewhat, I don't want to say concerned, but they have one issue that is of importance to them is the fact that complaints by a European citizen that go to the FTC currently, like there is no automatism that creates or that ensures that this complaint is being dealt with. So, and going forward, it would be of interest in the European interest that the FTC would take, let's say, a more engaged role or have take a more cooperative approach with the European DPA. So my question would be if this is anything that you would be looking into, that you're considering to sort of work closer with the European DPAs that handle the incoming requests by the European citizen.
So it's not surprising that I'm getting fabulous questions from such a wonderful audience. Another great question. In the US, the Federal Trade Commission has a system where we accept complaints directly and we accept complaints from many, many law enforcement agencies. We run a database that law enforcement accesses. It's highly confidential that the law enforcement in the US and other international partners can access. This database gets 2 million complaints a year. It's not just about privacy, it's about all sorts of consumer protection, competition, and privacy issues. It would be impossible for us to answer and to respond to each complaint, but we do make the complaints available very broadly to the law enforcement community. It also forms much, what we use it for is it forms our enforcement priorities. It's one of the ways that we determine what are the issues that we need to focus on. It's a fabulous database. But the reason we don't respond to each and every complaint, not first of all, it's not required by our law, which is very different from how the DPAs operate here in Europe. By law, they are required to respond to each complaint, and if they fail to do so adequately, they can actually be sued by the data subject. So that's different than it is in the United States. But also one of the reasons we don't reply to each and every complaint is back in the 1960s and 70s, both Ralph Nader and his group, as well as the American Bar Association, studied the FTC and how effective we were. And one of the complaints that both of them made, so this is kind of both sides of the spectrum, if you will, one of the complaints that they made was that the FTC was too focused on individual complaints. And as a result, we were not able to kind of pick up our head and see beyond what consumers understood to be problems. And what does this mean in the data ecosystem and the digital economy? What it means is consumers understand what's happening, or may understand what's happening with them with respect to consumer-facing companies, whether it's Facebook or Google or whatever, that is the companies that they're dealing with directly. But with respect to data brokers, going back to the previous question, with respect to analytics firms, with respect to ad networks, consumers don't have visibility into that. So if you're only focused on consumer complaints, look, it's important to respond to consumer complaints, but if you're only focused on consumer complaints because you don't have the resources to do anything but respond to individual complaints, you'll never focus on those very important players that consumers don't see. I also want to say, though, because again, our system's complicated in the United States, and many people in the US don't understand this either, so I'm not chastising Europeans for not understanding this. In addition to the Federal Trade Commission, state attorneys general also do consumer protection and privacy enforcement work. And state AGs often do run mediation services where they do respond to each and every consumer complaint. Mm-hmm. So often that happens at the state level in the United States rather than at the federal level. Okay, that's just my background, sorry, but now to your question, I know I'm driving Cherno. He said I needed to answer every question in 20 seconds, and obviously I'm failing completely to be a Huffington Post
person. Actually, you do. Person.
I know, but I told you, it's complicated. So, But with respect to this issue that you've raised, which I'll talk about in terms of how it's been portrayed in the press rather than the discussions that are underway, the FTC is very, we are very engaged with our DPA counterparts, our DPA colleagues in other countries around the world, but let's focus on here in Europe. First of all, we have been very involved with the International Conference of Data Protection and Privacy Commissioners. I have met with the Article 29 Working Party. Today, later on, I am meeting with the Landers DPAs. I'm meeting with the College of Landers DPAs to talk about some of these issues. It is very important for us to have conversations with our DPA counterparts, and to the extent that we can, to help them with respect to investigations or with respect to issues where we can help them. We do have a law in the United States, it's called the Safe Web Act, and it allows us to work with our counterparts around the world to help them with their investigations, whether it's through subpoena power in the United States or other ways that we can help them. It has some requirements. It requires that there be a law that our foreign counterparts are enforcing that has a corollary in US law. Safe Harbor would certainly fit that criteria, but right to be forgotten might not. So as long as, and there's other criteria too, we have to know that that counterpart in Europe would assist us. You know, it would be a mutual assistance. We have entered into, so we can use the Safe Web Act to assist our DPA colleagues. We have also entered into memorandum of understanding with three European DPAs, with the Dutch, with the British, and with the Irish. And that MOU allows us to more quickly engage in mutual cooperation if need be. And so that's also something that we could look at in terms of entering into MOUs with other DPAs. So there are mechanisms in place. We're very eager to help our DPA counterparts. Listen, Safe Harbor, when it was originally set up, we had expected that we would be getting referrals from DPAs here in Europe. That was the design of Safe Harbor. I'm not chastising anyone over this, but it is simply a fact that we got very, very, very few referrals from European DPAs with respect to potential Safe Harbor violations. So I'm hopeful that when the new transfer mechanism is established, that these issues will be addressed. How we can assist the DPAs and starting to get referrals of substance from the DPAs.
Hi, I'm Roland Peters from NTV Online, and I got a question about the relation of the FTC and the negotiations about the transatlantic TTIP. And how does that influence your work on renegotiating the Safe Harbor Act?
Thanks for that question. The Federal Trade Commission, despite the fact that it has trade in its name, we are actually not involved with TTIP negotiations. It's kind of a misnomer. The Federal Trade Commission is called the Federal Trade Commission because it's using a concept of the word trade back from the Progressive Era. We are actually a 100-year-old agency set up during the Progressive Era by Louis Brandeis, interestingly enough. Louis Brandeis, who was a close confidant of Woodrow Wilson, was one of the fathers of the FTC, in addition to being one of the fathers of modern privacy thought. But it's a concept of trade in the sense of like companies and consumers, and that it's so we are actually not as not involved with TTIP discussions. That's being run by the U.S. Trade Representative.
It surely influences your work.
Actually, no. We focus on consumer protection, competition, and privacy enforcement, and we look at cases as they come before us. I am not aware of any manner in which the discussion, the TTIP discussions are affecting our work.
Hi, my name is Jasmine, and I'm a research fellow doing research on transatlantic cybersecurity at the German Council on Foreign Relations. My question is a little bit more basic. So we talked about how the Freedom Act eliminated bulk metadata collection, correct? And so just to clarify, metadata consists of, for example, phone stamps, phone number, duration of the call. What would you say to people who criticize this as a modest change or an empty victory for the public because there is still surveillance that is just mass data collection with content as well?
Thanks for that question. I think there, I mean, as I said, that wasn't the only reform that took place in USA Freedom. I think you need to look at the scope of the act overall. I think another issue that would be interesting to focus on in terms of comparing how the surveillance community is regulated in the United States versus Europe would be to take a look at, for instance, how our Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board is functioning and all the work that they have done, and ask where is the Privacy and Civil Liberties Oversight Board in European member state countries. I think it would also be worthwhile to ask, again, trying to focus on the essential equivalence between the American system and the European legal order, which, as everyone knows, in Europe, security is done at the member state level. So if we're really going to breathe life into what the Schrems court said about the test being essential equivalence with the European legal order, we need to look at member state activity. So where's the Privacy Civil Liberties Oversight Boards in Europe? I'm not saying they don't exist. I'm just saying, where are they and what are they doing? Where is the presidential policy directive at the member state level that does, on at an executive level, has taken action and focused on the scope of security surveillance in the US? Where is that happening in Europe? Again, a question to be asked. The NSA has, my understanding is, has a regulatory, internal regulatory review group, a compliance, privacy and security review group that has 300 members. That is, they're overseeing the extent to which the NSA is complying with laws. Do those folks exist in the member state level here in Europe? I'm just raising the question. So I think my point is that if we're really going to focus on essential equivalence, we need to have an honest discussion about all that is taking place in the United States and have the same honest discussion about what is taking place here in Europe. And then we can talk about whether or not we have essential equivalence, or whether, in fact, the US system has more protections in place than may exist here in Europe. That's the question I would ask.
Mm-hmm. And what would be your answer to that question?
My answer is, I, as best I can tell from having lots of conversations mm-hmm. with European counterparts, is that a lot of these protections are not present here in Europe mm-hmm. where they are in the United States. But it's not for me to determine essential equivalence. It's for lots of others to determine that.
Hello, Fabian Vandenborg. I'm with the Federation of German Industries. I still haven't really understood one point that was discussed about the ECJ judgment, because you said it reinforced the perception in the US that privacy is a fundamental right when it comes to commercial issues. But as far as I understand the judgment, it was not about the commercial aspect, but about the social security exception and the I don't know if it's loophole, but the fact that the state or intelligence agencies could have access to these data that are exchanged on for a commercial purpose. So this is my question: how does this, how is this dilemma in a way resolved? Because if you look at what the commissioner said over the weekend, they basically asked the U.S. to change its surveillance system, and I don't think the U.S. is going to do that. So I think if you say this is about the data exchange for commercial purposes, I don't see that. My question is, does it really reflect the judgment of the ECJ and the concerns that are on the European side?
It's a great question. You know, again, it's complicated to give the 20-second answer.
You never took 20 seconds. So.
No. I'm going to try to answer this. It is absolutely true that the decision, you know, what's difficult and in some ways frustrating about it, look, and I'm not criticizing the decision. The decision is what it is. But it is focused on commercial firms and the safe harbor framework. That's the subject of the decision, yet all of the discussion is about security issues. And that is the, I don't know if we want to say the puzzle of it or whatever, but you know, these are issues that the companies can't really affect. The decision was not about their practices. The decision was not about the extent to which any particular company is abiding by the safe harbor principles, for instance. That was, as I said, was not part of the decision at all. But the reason why I said the decision was an important moment in the United States, because it brought to the fore that on the commercial side, privacy is a fundamental right, is because it impacted all the companies that were using safe harbor, right? I mean, it was not invalidating sort of national security rules. It was instead invalidating a rule that was something that commercial firms, 4,500 of them or thereabouts, were using. So, you know, the representative from Silicon Valley, one of the U.S. representatives from Silicon Valley, whose name is Anna Eshoo, called the Schrems decision, she said it was 7.8 on the Richter scale, meaning it was a huge earthquake. In fact, interestingly enough, the great earthquake and fire of 1906 in San Francisco was also 7.8 on the Richter scale. And that means what she's saying is it was a huge issue that suddenly appeared in Silicon Valley. And that's what I mean, is it brought to the fore this issue for US companies in a way that it hadn't impacted them so directly before. So I hope I'm answering your question, although I don't know that there is a really good answer to it, because of course you're right, and it's part of what I said about the decision, is that it has this frustrating or puzzling aspect to it, because it's using as a jumping board a commercial transfer mechanism to focus in on allegations back from 2013 about surveillance and government redress.
No, I understand there are no easy answers. I just think I would turn around the argument and say the narrative shouldn't be like blaming or lecturing each other, you have more privacy or we have more privacy, but the argument should be it's really about jobs and growth and a decision that affects transatlantic trade at the very core. So I think the way to change behavior or to have this on both sides of the Atlantic is to focus on the effect on the commercial side, rather than making the decision who has a better protection of privacy, because I think they're just different approaches and we're not going to harmonize them. And so I think I appreciate what you said. I just think it's very important that the business community fully grabs the potential impact of the decision. I think they're doing it.
Yes, I completely agree with your point, and that's what I was trying to say. So I completely agree with you.
My last question would be, you know, give me a time frame. When will the issue be solved? You know, we need something new. You know, Safe Harbor is gone. So what do we do? Where do we go from here? What do you think? Will it be solved in 2016?
Yes. I do think it will be solved. I mean, the immediate issue of developing a new framework, I think, should be resolved soon, and I think it will be resolved soon. I'm certainly, you know, as I said, hopeful. But there are the bigger issues, and as the last gentleman just pointed out, you know, how do we move forward in a way that will allow for the transfer of data for all the reasons he pointed out, whether it's jobs, whether it's economic growth, or from my perspective, whether it can happen in a privacy protective and consumer protective way. I think that's going to be an ongoing discussion. I also think the appropriate balance between privacy and security and encryption and all of the things that we've been talking about, that's going to be an ongoing discussion too. So while we need to focus immediately on whether we can put in place a new framework, and I think we can, and I think we should. The bigger discussion should be ongoing, and that's why having conversations like this is so important.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
FEC Commissioner Julie Brill here in Berlin.
Thank you. Thank you.